Hello, dear ones. It's Alice. I am of the stars, and I'm here to talk to you today about a groundbreaking topic, linking the study of psychology with the study of metaphysics and the occult. And the topics in question, the linking that will take place, have to do with what is termed in psychology the antisocial personality, and what is termed in the occult world the dark soul or the black soul. And I'm going to describe the same situation from these two different points of view, psychological and metaphysical. All right, this is, as far as I know, never been done before, and I hope it will be of help in dealing with this type of being that's present on Earth and is becoming discovered right now because of the awakening that's taking place. Let's talk about the occult first, the lost soul, the dark soul, the black soul, right? And the event called the loss of the soul. I'm taking my information from The Astral Body by Arthur Powell, which is based on the study of theosophy. And a number of different writers contributed to this idea sometime previous. So the loss of the soul in theosophy is considered to be when the quaternary is wrenched free of the higher principles in a man. And so the ego, the lower ego, which has to do with survival in the world and making one's way in the world, is separated from the higher ego, which has to do with aspirations towards the divine and towards cosmic understanding and like that, the desire to know God. So when this division in two of the energy fields of a person occurs, according to theosophy, he becomes like an animal with the cunning of a man, but with no principles and no conscience. This rending in twain of the energy bodies of a person can occur at death or even during life, according to theosophy. And the reason they say that it happens is that the lower body, which you might call the gut brain or the desire elemental or that combination of things in the lower part of the large intestine that's on the astral plane and also on the lower mental plane, is too wrapped up or tangled up in desire to wrench itself free of that, and so it sinks into desire, and it's unable to relate with the higher principles of a person. So this being that was once human and has been divided in half or rent in twain is known as an elementary, E-L-E-M-E-N-T-A-R-Y. When it exists on the astral plane only, after passing on, it has a very devastating effect on those it concentrates on the astral plane or on the physical plane. It is a being of quote-unquote terrible potency, whose depraved actions can cause great suffering in the astral realm and also in the physical world. So, and not only that, but it's capable of reincarnating sometimes if it has enough like lower energy, it can reincarnate in a form that's more like animal than human, and expresses itself in the through the lower mind, the gut brain, the lower triangle, and can continue to incarnate according to the teachings of Theosophy for some time until that energy of the lower triangle wears out, at which time it disintegrates and is lost, complete its experience as a learning ego attempting to know God is completely lost. And so this is a very unusual class of beings, of human beings, who devolve to loss of soul and to loss of personality, to loss of ego, and to eventual complete dissolution. Now, next I'd like to talk about the psychological category or label called antisocial personality. I've written quite a bit about antisocial personality. And first let's describe it. It's a group of people who behave without regard to conscience, who are uncannily aware of and able to motivate or manipulate other people through their quirks of personality, their faults and failings, and who I think often go undetected in the world because of their canniness, their shrewdness, their just, it seems, innate ability to understand the strictures of reaction under which societal expectations place most human beings. These antisocial personalities are also prone to taking risks. So they may find themselves in occupations that involve risk, such as con artist or drug dealer or sex worker or some few find themselves in very risky jobs in the military. Because they're attracted to the idea of taking other people's lives, I think that percent is very small. They're more likely to pose as people who have military experience or have some other credential, such as Secret Service credential or like that, something that gives them authority in the world, than they are to actually be that. This is because they can't abide having someone have authority over them. So also in terms of recreational activities, they tend to gravitate to the very unusual, such as serial killing and mass murder and that kind of thing. Then when they are caught and punished and an attempt is made to reintegrate them into the mainstream of society, my understanding is that this is not possible, that they need to be confined for life. Because their type of genetic makeup or personality problem isn't capable of finding solution and of being ameliorated. And I completely concur with this. I think it's impossible. In the occult literature, there's quite a bit about the reptilians, which is a topic I stay away from usually because it strikes fear in everybody's heart, and I'm not in favor of fear. But I'll mention it here as a possibility that people who are antisocial personalities or who have lost their souls in occult terms may have an alteration in their genetic makeup that is, you know, popularly called reptilian. And the reason it may be called reptilian might have to do with reptilian acting beings on the astral plane who place these changes in the DNA of otherwise normal people, or it might be because of the way that they act. The way that they act is very cold-blooded, very how we would think of a snake or a lizard or like that. So if this were true, if there's a patch in the genes of a certain group of people on Earth that causes them to be antisocial personalities and causes them to lose their souls and be rent in twain and like that, then through the languages of light and sound, it should be possible to repair the structure of the DNA during this new age of awakening. And that's the one light that I can hold out for this, is that it might be possible. Now I'd like to talk a little about the energy fields of the antisocial personality, who I also consider to be a person who has lost its soul. And this is from my own clear experience. And I'm speaking first of one individual. I may go into another individual who manifests differently in his energy bodies later. So I'll speak first of one individual. The story is that in his prior lifetime, he was involved in the Nazi death camps, and that he killed about 5,000 men, women, and children there, personally. Now what this kind of experience does to the lower mental body, the gut brain, is it greatly ratchets up the samskara for murder, and it places like a weight, an entanglement and a weight on the lower mental body, the gut brain, and the etheric net in that area that unbalances the etheric net, which is carried from lifetime to lifetime as a record of our personal karmas, our samskaras. So the etheric net of this person who passed on, who was guilty of so many murders of innocent people during World War II, that etheric net, when he died, would have been very distorted towards the dark. Then, this is just background to let you know what led up to what happened in this lifetime. There was a child that was born just about the same time as he passed on, that had carried his soul signature and etheric net wounding. And this child, in very early life, at maybe the age of, you know, his story in the astral plane is that he was 9, but my story is that he was younger than that. And the family was very poor, and the father was gone. It was out in the country in a farming area. And he attempted to sexual overtures to his mother from the back. She was lying on her side. She had a newborn baby, and there was this farmhouse out in the middle of nowhere. And he attempted, he had a sexual thought and climbed into bed with her, maybe to keep warm. And she rebuffed him and threw him out. And he became very angry and burned the house down. His mother and his infant brother passed. Everybody died, whoever it was that was in there. And the last scene there is that he found the body of his mother, charred body of his mother. The picture I have is outside the house, and he was very hungry, and he was also very distraught and desolate over the death of those who could help keep him alive. You know, he'd lost his support system and his mother, and everything was gone. And he knelt down on the ground, and he, in a prayerful stance, and he thought that it would be all right to eat a little of his mother, who looked, I guess, like, you know, fried chicken or something at that point. So he tried eating a little of his mother. And at that point, instilled in his lower mental body, was a symbol or an subconscious archetypal image or symbol of great like density and great import to him. The symbol was that to pray, you know, pray with, like, pray to God, was to pray on someone, P-R-E-Y. P-R-A-Y, P-R-E-Y. These became in his mind the same thing. His prayer in life was to pray on other human beings. And so began a long history of murder and cannibalism related to repression of the sexual drive. So there's that unconscious symbol that he carries. And just before that symbol was installed as like the latchkey or lock of his conception of reality, he had the notion that everything was blown to smithereens, everything was blown to bits. And in his mind, he pictured that his mind was blown apart into tiny bits. And he regressed to a state of like infancy, the first few years of life, at very early infancy, really, I think, when a person doesn't make a distinction between himself and other people. He had lost everyone. He became like this, to him, he was the only person in the world, and everything in the world was all torn asunder inside his head, his higher mental body, okay? It was all like completely destroyed, right? And so his image at that moment of other people became one that they were tiny parts of his own brain, that if he were to concentrate very hard with his willpower, he could pull that all those people back together into his brain and make everything work again. Well, so I've talked a little in past blogs about paranoid schizoid personality caused by loss in early childhood, which this may also be considered from the point of view of. That theory bears out the notion that everything in the world is just a part of the person who experiences this kind of Weltanschauung. I know it's not logical, but that's sometimes in times of great crisis, a reintegration of the worldview occurs that's kind of a patchwork or a makeshift that in the intuition pulls us in, because otherwise there would be no way to function whatsoever. Of course, these conclusions that he drew were not in line with what everybody else thinks of, because everybody else comes to the conclusion that there is I and that there is other and there's a give and take that takes place. Further, everybody else has a connection between their higher mind and their lower mind, and that connection is in the heart center, the strongest chakra of the body, of energy systems of the body. When this rending in twain, this cutting apart of the higher and lower minds occurred in this young person, the heart itself changed the way that it functioned. Most people's hearts have a funnel and a back funnel, and there's a kind of a constant balance and flow between the two that allows the person to give love to other people and to receive love back from them. Yes. In the case of this person, what happened was because he did not His worldview did not admit that there were other people. So for him, there was no, like, soul purpose in sending energy of the heart out. But instead, when he's with other people, what happens is a constant drain on their energy fields and a drawing of the heart's energy into him. This is what a dark soul is. It's like a sponge that draws in the love of every other person and never gives any out. Okay, so they're kind of a parasitic force in the world that would surely die if other people were not there to provide that energy for their heart, because they don't have that love at all. That love is missing from them. The heart chakra is too badly damaged by this rending in twain process. Now, what happened at the time when his mind was blown is really that many functions of his mind, his brain, stopped working. He stopped having the ability to develop into something that worked. For instance, he can't read, he can't write, he can't do arithmetic. Sometimes he can't see very clearly, or he can't see at all. He imagined that the parts of his higher mind had blown apart and become a little higher, settled out a little higher up over here, around the area of the crown chakra, or the next higher chakra. And there is where whatever awareness he would have had in his mind, in his brain, began to exist up here. The missing, you know, half of his energy field was up here. He relied upon this intelligence up here to reach out in a kind of a lightning strike from the hara line that exists, you know, through the center of our body, reaches out in a kind of a blue and white lightning strike into the auric fields or energy fields of other people. And because of that, because of how high it is up here, up above the thinking mind in other people, he can brain control them. Now, up here, there's a lot of soul wounding. There's all this splintering, this inability to recognize I and other and so forth. And up here, what strikes out at other people becomes attached to them and brain controls them from above their cognitive center and reaches down through the core of their being, affecting every single chakra with a similar kind of soul wounding until this energy that he has is withdrawn from them. Strikes out over and over again in an attempt in his own child's mind to connect these people that he knows about who are not him with him, to make them one part of him and to thus reunite all the splintered portions of his higher mind. In other words, an antisocial personality thinks that all the people are part of him and all of the people have the same emotional context as he has. For instance, in the case of this antisocial personality that's the topic of this video, he believes that everybody is his enemy, and that nobody wants to love him, that nobody wants to support him. He has to mind control them in order to get them to love him, and that they are all out to get other people, just like he is. So it's mirror image kind of astral stories for him. If he thinks of someone and he enters someone, he starts stories about the people that they know that are very similar to what he would do to people if he were those other people. You know, everybody's him, in other words. It's the same soul wounding, no matter what. Uh, If the antisocial personality is able to extend his soul signature down through the center of the electromagnetic field of a person that he's obsessing, down to the area of the lower of the gut brain, the lower mind, and if that permeation or saturation of the soul field of this flow through person, this second person, continues for some time, then on the psychic plane, on the astral plane, you will find a psychic cord or astral cord forms between the navel point of the second person and the navel point of the antisocial personality, that is, it becomes very large. It becomes about 6 inches in diameter. And so this is the astral expression of the fact that the lower mind or gut brain of the second person is being controlled by the repressed gut brain of the antisocial personality. And you will also find a constant sexual stimulation occurring in the second person as a flow through of the repressed energy, the soured, repressed energy, the soul wounded, repressed energy of the antisocial personality. If this gut brain energy obsesses one person and then another person and so forth, the effects will be less severe. The psychic cording will be smaller and more easily broken, and the obsessional thoughts about sexuality and killing or death will be sporadic rather than constant. So none of these, neither the occasional obsession nor the constant obsession, is something that one would desire to have in one's life. So the minute that one feels the energies of such a person, such a being, start to permeate down through their own electromagnetic field, it's important to act. Take action right away, evasive action. For example, lying down on the ground, walking in nature, meditating with your feet flat on the floor, coloring with your coloring pencils. Or here's one more rather out there technique. If you can hear the person that's trying to obsess you, if you're good with astral hearing, you can talk to them as if they were a 2-year-old child and that you love, a toddler that you love, and ask them something physical. Ask them about what they're wearing. What kind of shoes do they have on? What color is their belt? You know, ask them if they're hungry. When was the last time they ate? What was it that they had to eat? Ask them what they're doing right now. Ask them if they're cold or if they're too warm. Ask them if the lights are on or not on, if it's plenty bright where they are. Ask them something about their physical reality. And that will bring them back from the astral plane back into their own physical body. And then you will find that you have much less trouble with that issue of obsession by the other person. Okay, so there are two techniques. One is to ground yourself, or to change the way that you think, so that you're thinking not with your left brain, which has a tendency to trap you into logical issues, but rather with your right brain. And the other is to ground the other person with the way that you talk to them on the astral plane. There are going to be more solutions for more things at the end of this video, okay, in a section about solutions. One other thing that struck me about my research into Charles Manson is that one of his followers said there was a phase where he would have them play role after role every day, a different role, until finally they identified with no role. And the idea was that they would live in just the now moment. And somehow they were divorced from from personality in that way, I think, and or they became identified with no particular like routine of acting. And so when he then asked them to do exactly as he said and had them massacre a bunch of people, they asked no questions about that. Because as they played role after role, he would have them obey his will exactly and change exactly as he told them to. In other words, his will was the law of the land, you know, the paramount. This, in fact, is one quality of the antisocial personality, a lost soul, is that they cannot accept authority and that they must be in charge of everything completely. They would, in fact, prefer that nobody else spoke but them or thought but them, because they think these people don't exist. They have no... They probably think they have no personality, because they, the antisocial personalities, have lost that glue that holds people together, that is the personality. I mentioned earlier in this video how the heart chakra of the antisocial personality is damaged in such a way that he is unable to create love with it, either to sustain himself or to let flow out to the world. Instead, what he needs to do in order to replenish his energy system is to suck in the energy of other people. So I'm about to describe a little more about the consequences of that that imbalance in the heart chakra of the antisocial personality. Now, the process of other people always being drained of energy and never receiving energy back from a person is detrimental to their health, and so there are many deaths and diseases that are associated with people who are physically close to this person or who are considered a part of this person. They need not be near physically, because through this process of the higher mental body that's cut off and zinging out to people all the time, trying to connect with other people and recreate the integrated brain, that process sends his energy down through those people and drains them of energy and also changes their soul signature temporarily to a very sour negative note, similar to his own soul signature. And so the thoughts that he has, you see, that flow down through these other people have to do with injury to them, with death to them, with sending them disease and so forth. Why this is, I don't know, but that's how that energy takes place from a distance, that destructive energy. You can see from this intuitive description of the energy system of the antisocial personality or lost soul that the great damage done to the etheric net will, either in this lifetime or in subsequent lifetimes, make it impossible for this energy field to persist. The end depends entirely for its continuation on siphoning energy from other people. This may or may not be available to the person. If the person is caught and put in jail because of the many murders that he has committed, or in some cases she has committed, then he will be in tight quarters with a bunch of other people, all of whom he can reach through telepathic communication and all of whom he can siphon off their loving and their heart energy and the very vital essence of their being. So merely putting this person in jail won't solve the problem. It'll just allow him to take the lives of many others, including the jailers. Killing this person is also not such a good option, as I understand it, as then he becomes this very potent force for evil on the astral plane as an elementary. Also not so terrific, because he may choose to haunt that very place where he was killed and cause all kinds of terrible things to happen. This is a very difficult question here. An antisocial personality very early in life will accrete around himself or herself helpers or alter egos, sometimes in the form of a cult, sometimes just a wife with friends, probably in addition, who he can dip into any time and use their mental abilities, their higher mind abilities, and for the sake of presenting himself before other people in a socially acceptable way. For instance, he will use their minds to as instantaneous cues. It's as if he's obsessing or inhabiting these other people, basically. And so whatever energy field he dips into at the time becomes his persona in before other people. He uses these other personalities for social cues, for higher cognitive abilities such as reading, writing, and arithmetic, analytical ability, knowledge about the world, knowledge about history, knowledge about every aspect of philosophy and so forth. So depending on the person that he's dipping into at the moment, his personality will subtly change and his basis of knowledge of things will change too. A lot of the time you'll find one wife, say, which will be the more refined mental atmosphere that he presents to people as if it were his own higher mind. And this wife will never leave him because he needs to be physically near her all the time in order to function in the world. She won't be able to go anywhere without him. Then you will find as his lifeline progresses that he most likely has a series of wives, all of whom he kills eventually. And in addition, and he will have an alter ego who is a man. Now, this man who is the alter ego will be the one that he dips into to carry out the functions of his lower mind, his gut brain, the repressed sexual and aggressive energies. So this other alter ego, the mind, will be the one who does his killing and his raping and his torture for him. And he will participate in that as blended with the other person, as obsessing that person. Okay, so in his mind, it will be he that is the personality, the same person, he that is his wife while she is alive. Since he's a man, in most cases, he will eventually kill her and reject that she is he. But then he must seek another constant companion to provide all of the higher brain functions for him and offer a personality that he can present before the world. See? Then for the man may be a long-term ally who offers him the chance to obsess and act out in the real world the functions of his feral instincts. Yeah. So in this way, he participates secondhand in reality, and causes others to act out. So as he obsesses and jumps from person to person, each of these people will be driven mad by the taint of the strange, turn of his emotional body, which flows through them and turns them in that direction temporarily. So you'll see around him cases of insanity cropping up all over and then disappearing mysteriously. People will perform acts they would never perform, depraved acts, and then suddenly stop performing them because they're no longer obsessed by him. Around this kind of person, a lot of times you'll see what's termed the killing cult, like the Charles Manson phenomenon. Sometimes he will hide in the open as a family man, as was the case with Dennis Rader, the BTK killer in Wichita. It looks to me like Dennis Rader's etheric net was less distorted to the dark than the etheric net of the person I've been talking about. It seems likely to me that he is one incarnation behind the person in the astral story I've just presented. Rader was able to get several degrees, to hold down job after job, and had a steady family life for decades. In addition to being a serial killer by his own hand and not through a mind-controlled alter ego. In this lifetime, he was accreting samskaras of murder to his gut brain or quaternary, just as the person in my astral story accreted samskaras of murder via his many murders in the Nazi death camps in his prior lifetime. So Rader, I'm supposing, is on his way to full antisocial personality status, but insufficiently weighed down by gut-brain karma to undergo the rending in twain process as of yet. This would mean, hypothetically, that he might still make a soul decision to reverse his course of action toward the light, and in so doing, might turn from the process of soul devolution to the greatly more salutary process of soul evolution. In this way, his soul might be saved. In this halfway there status, Rader was like the second antisocial personality that I'm going to discuss. So I mentioned earlier that I know about another case of loss of soul, or potentially of loss of soul, that I've experienced or had witnessed in this lifetime. And I don't know as much detail about that, except that that person committed countless crimes in this lifetime, many to do with drug sales or various kinds of sexual license and killing wives and all kinds of crazy things, you know, killing for pleasure and killing for sexual gratification and so forth, time after time. So this lifetime for that person was greatly weighed down with samskaras in the gut brain, terribly weighed down, and the heart became so negatively aspected that a stream of hatred issued forth from it day and night, a vast stream of hatred issued out of it. And so something happened, I don't know what, and maybe, most likely, I only saw it on the astral plane, but most likely on the physical plane, there was an auto accident or some other a drug overdose or something happened, so that the life was lost, but not in the usual way, not where a person merely steps out of the body and onto the astral plane. No. Instead, he was his astral form was sucked up through a wormhole that was like not a straight line wormhole. It was large and small and wide, different diameters, winding it here and there, all off into space, and from near me, somewhere near me on the astral plane, it disappeared. There was all this carrying on in commotion, these screams of fear and so forth. And it is possible that what I witnessed on the astral plane was the dissolution of a soul. This because of the great wounding to the etheric net caused by the person's karmic intake during this lifetime. So I wish I knew more about that. That's all I really do know. I at the time when I wrote that up, I wasn't really sure what happened, and I offer this as one possibility. Very, to me, daunting and terrifying possibility, but one which I expect will be rarely, if ever, experienced on New Earth. I certainly hope so. So here's another thing that I've discovered in reaching out telepathically through the chakras above the head to mind control other people. The antisocial personality will, when he invades their energy fields, he will term himself their husband or their lover in every case. This is like a patchwork or makeshift device to link his worldview, which is extraordinarily different from most, in with the common worldview that a feral bonding for the sake of heart chakra things, but instead when he does feral bonding, it's pack bonding. Pack bonding, he's the alpha male. So every woman that he invades is his wife, and every man that he invades is his sub-lieutenant, his lover. This is because his gut brain functioning at that level, at the level of the feral drives to aggression and sex. When they find expression, when that energy, that pet energy, that V hyphen hyphen hyphen, D hyphen 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 energy is released or unrepressed or allowed to spring forth and express itself, it expresses itself in a very bestial way, in the way that a cougar might do, or a raptor, a bird of prey. You know, it expresses itself as pure bestial animal energy. It's because the heart energy is not working right in the antisocial personality. It's working backwards, drawing at the same time, drawing energy out of the person, siphoning energy off of the person, while these feral drives are forcing the person to enact some behavior. It's pretty unusual situation, I feel. Yeah. Here's another problem. Because this person has the ability to mind control other people from the chakras higher than the physical body, and to send his energy down through them and to relate like in an interquark way with them, he can create, he can unite with their thoughts, keeping in mind that he himself has no higher thoughts. He can unite with their thought processes and create the feeling in them that he is exactly the same as they are, because his mind is exactly the same as theirs is. And this is the basis of the formation of a cult of people who are greatly devoted to an antisocial personality or a lost soul. They do this because he mind controls each of them and mimics their mental processes or just becomes one with them by uniting his soul wounding and emotional like injury with their personality, because he has no personality. Okay, so when they see him, they think that he is them. It's like falling in love, you know, where at first you think, this person is just like me, the person that I've always longed for. Then 6 months later, their personality becomes clear and they're different from you, you know. Except in this case, he has no personality. He's in fact invading their space and their auras because he needs them to give him money, because he can't make money. There's nothing that he can do in the world, and he needs them to figure out math problems, to figure out to read and to write for him, and to make his way in the world. You know. So he's in essence very cunningly using their brain instead of his to figure out the things that don't work at all in his brain. He might even use them for his eyes. He might not be able to see on the physical plane, but he can go out through the energy above his head to someone else who can see, unite his soul wounding with theirs, cause them in this way to do serial killing or to rob or to rape or whatever it is that's within his, like, samskaric wounding, natural. He can cause them to do that, and yet they will be completely devoted to him because of this mirroring, this personality, like, mirror play that goes on that makes them think that he's the same as them. And that, in fact, was the case with, for instance, Charles Manson, who remotely caused a number of vicious murders through his followers, and he himself never did anything. He stayed out of the whole fracas, you know. So now I'd like to speak to two techniques that can be used by the person who feels his or her personal space begins to be invaded by a lost soul or an antisocial personality. The first has to do with noticing that an energy not yours is, like, perched on top of your head. You'll hear on the psi plane, on the clair plane, you'll hear something like, "My mind to your mind," spooky-like, right? And now I am inside of you, or something like that. and so, the first thing I ever tried is your mind to the mind of God, and that works because that breaks the sideways connection between his above his mind about the eighth chakra and above your. Cognitive practices around your eighth chakra, and it sends a beam of light up from your hara back up to source itself. So that will break through. The second thing that can be done is to visualize a diamond white column of light above your head and as wide as your head, going from about your eyebrows, where the pituitary and pineal gland, the third eye point, are located, maybe at the level of your eyes, on up to about 3 feet above your head. Imagine very brilliant white column of light to do that. And just continue to visualize that, and that will also clear a part of your hara line that's above your head of these torqued or distorted or darkened energies that are held in the soul or unsoul of the antisocial personality, the lost soul. So there are two visualizations: my mind to the mind of God and the bright white column of light as wide as your head. I'd just like to add an aside regarding antisocial personalities who are incarcerated. I think you'll find around them, as I've mentioned elsewhere in this video, croppings up of insanity amongst those that they know. They may keep a list of people that they obsess. These may be people that write to them or correspond with them or show up in person to talk to them. They may be jailers or they may be prisoners. Long lists of people that they pop into and pop out of and temporarily drive insane. I think one prison management method might be to move them from one cell to another when things get obsessional in a particular block, so that they have to develop new relationships, and this may take some time. So this is a low-cost way of managing the antisocial personality flow-through effect of insanity on other people. Try to minimize time spent with him, and try not to think of him. Try not to correspond with him or email him or anything. Don't talk to him. And that way he won't be led to do that. Further possibility to try is to try orientation of the bed, for prisoners. And I know this is most likely optional in prisons, but the information could get out there that if people sleep with their head to the rising sun, their head to their east, and their feet to the west where the sun sets, then they are less likely to be caught up in obsessional activities. They're less likely to fall prey to the unconscious thought cloud of the world, and this may cut down on acting out and insane behaviors in prisons. It's a case-by-case thing, though. Some people feel better using other sleeping orientations, so experimentation will be required. And on with the main topic. So now I'd like to turn to people who have been flowed through to by an antisocial personality. In other words, people who have been mind-controlled by an antisocial personality or black soul. When a person is in sort of a mental hostage situation, where they can't escape from someone else's soul wounding, especially in a situation that's remote like that, remote mind control, and sometimes if the person is physically close to the antisocial personality, as is the case in when an antisocial personality is in prison and has cellmates around him, then it gives the impression, in fact is true unless you have the proper tools at hand, that you're being held hostage by someone else's mind, right? And I thought about this, and I thought, this is like the Patty Hearst syndrome, which is called Stockholm syndrome, which is when you do what you can to get by because you can't escape. It's also called the fawn syndrome, where a fawn is like confronted with a great predator, like the baby deer is confronted with a great predator, and then tries to play with the predator because it has no other options. It can't fight. It really can't run away far. It's confronted with a predator that's far more fierce and strong and incredibly fearsome than it is. And so what it tries to do is it tries to go along and get along in that way. It tries to do whatever the predator says, like that. And I think that's frequently characteristic of people who are being mind controlled by these people called antisocial personalities or black souls. I can see why sometimes they're given more pejorative names like the controllers and the hybrids or the reptilians, because people feel like they can't escape them. And so they do this fawn syndrome, this fawn reflex, fight or flight. Neither one of those works. Instead, they cave in. And so in coming out of that, as soon as you've been able to neutralize the antisocial personality with one of the techniques that I've explained here, or more that are probably in the astral air and to come to humankind soon. The thing to do is to read up on Stockholm syndrome, its causes, and its treatments, and to use that information to recover as soon as possible from the trauma of remote mind control. So, that's my thought on that. Y'all take care. Love you lots.